Redwood trees are the tallest plants in the world. At up to 380 feet tall, these giant organisms need to transport water from their roots all the way to their leaves. In order for humans to pump water to the same height, equivalent to a 30-story building, we would need massive water pumps that use a ton of energy. So, how do redwood trees accomplish this Herculean task? While humans need advanced technology to move water, cells in plants and animals have evolved incredible mechanisms for dealing with different environments, transporting water, and maintaining homeostasis. This video will dive into the complexities of tonicity, osmoregulation, and water potential. There will definitely be questions about this material on the AP biology test, so follow along with us as we look at tonicity and osmoregulation in organisms and cover everything you need to know. This video covers section 2.8 of the AP Biology curriculum. We will start with a discussion of tonicity and how we can compare different solutions based on their solute concentrations using words like hypertonic, hypotonic, and isotonic. Then, we'll take a look at water potential and the water potential equation we can use to predict the movement of water. After the first quiz, we'll look at how plants manipulate their cells to decrease the water potential and drive water up to their leaves. Finally, we'll look at how animals deal with different tonicities in different environments. If you only need to review one of these topics, feel free to skip forward to the times outlined here. Otherwise, let's get started. A solution is formed when a solute, such as an ion, a polar molecule, or another substance, dissolves into a solvent, a liquid capable of separating solute molecules. In living systems, the solvent is always water. The solute dissolved in water can be anything from small charged ions to large polar glucose molecules. The phenomenon of hydrogen bonding is constantly separating these molecules and trying to distribute them evenly as each water molecule tries to maximize its number of hydrogen bonds. Osmolarity is a term used to describe the concentration of solutes within a given volume of water. A high osmolarity means there are many solutes dissolved in a solution, whereas a low osmolarity describes a solution where there are few solutes dissolved in the solution. The term tonicity refers to a set of terms we can use to compare two solutions and predict how the water molecules and solute particles will react if the two solutions meet. If we are trying to determine the tonicity of two solutions, there are three terms we can use: hypertonic, hypotonic, and isotonic. The important thing to remember is that these are comparative terms. You cannot describe a single solution using the terms of tonicity. For example, a certain sports drink may have an osmolarity of 300 millimoles per kilogram. Without another substance to compare to, you cannot determine whether this sports drink is isotonic, hypertonic, or hypotonic. It depends entirely on the substance you are comparing it to. A solution is described as isotonic to another solution if they have the same concentration of solutes diluted by the same amount of solvents. In other words, two solutions with the same osmolarity are considered isotonic to each other. For example, if you pour the sports drink into two glasses, each has an osmolarity of 330 millimoles per kilogram, so the two solutions are isotonic to each other. By contrast, a hypertonic solution has more dissolved solutes than the solution it is being compared to. For instance, if we were to compare the sports drink to pure water, we would say that the sports drink is hypertonic compared to the pure water. Finally, a hypotonic solution is one that has fewer dissolved solutes than the solution it is being compared to. Let's say we are trying to compare water to the sports drink. Now, we would say that the water is hypotonic compared to the sports drink. Notice how this is the same comparison, though now the water is the object we are focusing on instead of the sports drink. We can use these terms to describe the environment a cell is in. Since water can flow through the cell membrane, cells that experience different tonicities are subject to different effects. If a cell is in an isotonic environment, the solution surrounding the cell has the exact same osmolarity as the solution within the cell. This means that the cell will exchange water molecules into and out of the cell at the same rate. If a cell is placed in a hypotonic environment, the solution outside the cell has fewer dissolved solutes than the solution inside the cell. Since water can flow through the cell membrane, water will pack into the cell in an effort to correct this imbalance. This can pressurize the water in the cell and cause lysis, or ruptures in the cell membrane, if the imbalance is too much. By contrast, if we place a cell in a hypertonic environment, it will become shriveled. This is because there is a higher concentration of solutes outside of the cell. Therefore, the water inside of the cell will begin to move out of the cell to try to bring the two solutions into equilibrium. Think about this. Tonicity is incredibly important to how individual organisms function. Consider these two groups of fish. The fish on the coral reef live in a solution with a very high osmolarity. Salt water is loaded with ionic salts and other substances. By contrast, the koi fish live in a freshwater environment. Freshwater has very few dissolved solutes and an overall low osmolarity. So, each of these organisms must have different adaptations to keep their cells from lysing or shriveling in their given environments. Think about how these cells of these different fish might function as we dive into the concept of water potential. Water potential is a measure of the potential energy of water that a solution carries when compared to pure water. You can think about it this way. Because of water's ability to form hydrogen bonds, water can physically move polar substances and ions. Moving anything takes energy. So, pure water has a lot of potential energy stored up. It has the potential to move large amounts of solutes. When you add solutes to the water, some of the hydrogen bonds are used to surround and distribute the solutes, so the entire solution has a lower amount of potential energy. Or you could also say that the entire solution has a lower water potential. There are many things that can affect water potential. Scientists use the letter psi from the Greek alphabet to denote water potential. The total water potential of a given solution is equal to all the individual aspects of water potential added together. We can add up the pressure potential, the solute potential, the gravity potential, the matrix potential, and many other aspects that contribute to the potential energy stored in a solution to get the overall water potential. In this course, we will focus only on two of these forces, the pressure potential and the solute potential. Consider this experiment. If we were to fill up a small bathtub with water and divide it in half with a cell membrane, we can replicate how tonicity affects the internal and external environment of a cell. We can measure the water potential of each half of this system. If we add salt to one side of the membrane, we are decreasing the solute potential on this side of the membrane. Since all other things remain the same, the saltwater side now has a lower water potential than the freshwater side. This means that water will move by osmosis across the membrane to the saltwater side. By the same logic, if we increase the pressure potential on the saltwater side by pushing downward on the water would move back through the membrane as the decrease in solute potential was countered. Now that we have covered the basics of tonicity and water potential, let's see if you can apply what you've learned to answer some complex questions. Pause the video now and take this short quiz. You can find all of the answers to these questions in this video through the quick test prep link in this video's description. Plants are different from animals in that they prefer a hypotonic solution to surround all of their cells. You may remember that a hypotonic solution can cause red blood cells to lyse. This is because animal cells do not have a cell wall. Plants can pack their cells with water in order for the cells to be rigid, also known as turgidity. This turgidity is what allows plants to stand tall and have a defined structure. If you pour salt on a plant's roots or otherwise bathe it in a hypertonic solution, the cells will be drained of water, become plasmolyzed, and the plant will collapse. When it comes to water potential, plants live by a simple rule. The water potential of the soil must be greater than the roots, which themselves must have a higher water potential than the stems, which must have a higher water potential than the leaves, which must have a higher water potential than the atmosphere. Plants can actively control the water potential of their tissues by adding solutes, like ions and glucose, to their cells. This lowers the water potential of cells higher in the plant, allowing water to easily travel up the stem. This is essentially how massive redwoods get all the water they need all the way up to their leaves. Is all this talk of water potential making you thirsty? Now's a good time to take a quick break, stretch your legs, and get a drink. When we come back, we'll see how animals deal with different tonicities and manipulate water potentials. Animals deal with different tonicities in different ways, depending on both their evolution and the environment they live in. Let's consider the freshwater and the saltwater fish from earlier in this video. The freshwater fish has a problem. It lives in a hypotonic environment. That means that the cells in the freshwater fish are much more concentrated than the external environment, and they want to stay that way. Because of the dilute environment it lives in, water is constantly entering the fish through its mouth, gills, and skin. The kidneys of this freshwater fish are constantly removing excess water from its body, creating very dilute urine. Let's compare that to the saltwater fish. The saltwater fish lives in a hypertonic environment, meaning the solution outside of the fish contains more dissolved solutes than within the fish's cells. This means that the fish is constantly losing water via osmosis through the skin and gills to the outside environment. To compensate for this water loss, a saltwater fish must not only drink water, but it must also have much more efficient kidney to create highly concentrated urine to conserve water. Now that we have covered how plants and animals deal with different tonicities and water potentials, let's see if you can apply your new knowledge to some questions. Pause the video and take this short quiz. You can find answers to all these questions through the quick test prep link in this video's description. Don't forget to check out all of our AP Biology resources for this section that can also help you study for the big test. Thanks for watching. Please like this video if you found it helpful and informative. Leave us any questions or comments you have about tonicity or water potential, and be sure to subscribe to the Biology Dictionary channel to easily find all of our AP Biology videos and resources. Good luck!